Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 15060 in the name of Miles Briggs on funding for teachers and schools in Scotland. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. I would advise the Chamber we have absolutely no time in hand. Members will be required to stick to their speaking allocations. Starting your peroration at the point where you should be concluded will result in your microphone being switched off. And on that point, I call on Miles Briggs to speak to and move the motion up to 7 minutes. Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think you make a good head teacher, actually, from what you just said. But can I start by thanking my Scottish Conservative colleagues, Liam Kerr and Sue Webber, for the power of work which they both undertook as my party spokesman on education and also as the convener of the Parliament's Education Committee. And can I start also by saying, when I'm taking up this role, I really do look forward to working with the Cabinet Secretary and other education spokespeople from other parties. We on these benches want to work to make sure all of our young people have the best start in life. So I'm pleased that Scottish Conservatives are using our first party business debate under Russell Finlay's leadership to raise the concerns of parents, teachers and our young people themselves at the situation we see in many of our classrooms today. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm proud of the fact that I attended good state primary and secondary schools in Perthshire. I think for many of us, looking back, the good, high-quality, comprehensive Scottish education gave us the opportunity to get ahead regardless of our background. A system where teachers had the freedom and ability to focus on teaching and making sure young people were equally focused on learning and achieving the best outcomes they can. And I know from teachers I've spoken to since being given this job that in schools today, they want to have the same opportunities to deliver for our young people. But reforms over the last few years have seen a significant decline in that opportunity, and we have seen that now in outcomes with the decline in literacy and numeracy. After almost two decades of SNP rule, the opportunity for our young people to succeed has been undermined. Our global reputation has been severely tarnished and standards have been allowed to fall. Subject choices have shrunk and our schools are plummeting down international educational league tables. New data published in August shows the pass rate for National 5, higher and advanced higher qualifications have all now fallen, with the attainment gap between the richest and poorest pupils in our country increasing. Because we have to be honest that not all is well in Scottish education. But if we're going to realise the potential of all our young people, we urgently need to fix these problems, the problems facing our schools, and help to restore Scottish education standards to where they should be, at the top of international education league tables. Deputy Presiding Officer, after 25 years of devolution, educational decline has taken place in Scotland. Most of that time has been under this SNP government. We know there is real concern at the Cabinet Secretary's decision to withhold £145 million in funding from local authorities. This will risk teacher numbers from across Scotland declining further at a very time when we are seeing teacher numbers fall over the last 2 years. That's why parents, teachers and young people are concerned that we see a real threat to teachers' numbers in Glasgow and a threat to the school week in Falkirk. Ministers cannot just blame councils for the situation when it is SNP ministers here in Holyrood who are holding the purse strings. We need to see a proper national workforce plan, and it should shame SNP ministers that so many qualified teachers are already struggling to obtain permanent employment in Scotland today, with the Scottish Teachers for Permanence campaign estimating that over 3,800 qualified teachers in Scotland are searching for permanent workplaces across the country. The situation is unacceptable and the teacher profession is looking for leadership, not excuses. Furthermore, the SNP's consistent underfunding of local authorities has placed additional support need services in a precarious situation, with the numbers consistently declining since 2010, with over 250,000 pupils in Scotland needing additional support. They have been consistently let down by this SNP government, which has overpromised and under-delivered. Pupils, parents and teachers deserve better. Deputy Presiding Officer, on these benches we've always looked to work constructively and deliver for our young people. That's why I have to say today I have a major concern around the decline in literacy levels we are seeing in Scotland, with more than one in four Scottish state pupils not achieving literacy levels. If our young people cannot read, they cannot learn. Scotland faces a growing literacy crisis, with up to 30% of secondary students reading two or more years below their age level, with some many far behind that. Scotland's literacy challenges are not a recent development, but they are getting worse. The Clackmannanshire study, published in early 2000, was a landmark piece of research, and ministers have failed to deliver that. At the very same time, we are seeing literacy rates in England improving. We need to learn from some of the teachings happening down south, and specifically I make an appeal to the Cabinet Secretary to look towards how we can reform literacy in schools. Looking towards phonics teaching is something I have been looking at over our recess, and certainly it is compelling findings from the work taking place in English schools. And I hope that's something the Cabinet Secretary will be open to pursue, because the effectiveness of phonics is quite obvious now. The study recently looking at children taught with phonics not only excelled in word reading but also in comprehension and spelling. Despite these compelling findings, though, Scotland has made limited progress in implementing the study's recommendations at a national level here. That's why I make no apologies for the approach I intend to take to focus on outcomes and looking to how we can empower our teaching professionals. Deputy Presiding Officer, to conclude, there's nothing more important for the future of Scotland than the education we provide for our young people, to enable them to really go on to achieve their potential. After 17 years of SNP government, the fact is classroom standards are plummeting, violence is rising, and it is young Scots, often from the most poorest backgrounds, which are being left behind. Now, teacher numbers in Scotland are declining, secure full-time posts are scarce, and cuts to school hours and additional support assistance numbers are at risk. In the coming weeks and the coming months ahead of the election, we on these benches will demonstrate how we want to bring common sense back to our classrooms and put Scottish education where it should be, back at the top of international league tables. And I move amendment in my name.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. Exemplary timekeeping to kick us off. I now call on Jenny Eagle-Ruth to speak to and move Amendment 15060.3. Up to 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, may I start by taking the opportunity to welcome Miles Briggs to his new position in education. I know he cares passionately about improving outcomes for Scotland's children and young people, and in that endeavour he will always find an ally in me. He made a number of points in relation to phonics and literacy, issues that I'm particularly interested in. And I'll give him a commitment today that I will come back in government time to debate those very issues with a focus on how we can improve literacy post-pandemic. Today I want to listen to the challenge from the opposition, and as the government amendment sets out, we'll call on the Parliament to unite behind a basic principle that teacher numbers in Scotland should be maintained and that local authorities should use the £145.5 million on offer from the Scottish Government for that purpose. Presiding Officer, Scotland's teachers are the beating heart of our education system. They play a really crucial role in our children's education, and they are vital to our collective ambition to close the poverty-related attainment gap. And so I say to my former profession today, this government values you, your expertise, and the compassion which you provide our young people with every day. The extra mile you go for our children makes a difference, and we are lucky as a country to have you. There is not a single MSP in this chamber, nor a political party, who believes that these very real challenges that Miles Briggs has outlined, faced by our schools today, will be solved by having fewer teachers in our schools. So I'm asking colleagues across the chamber today to unite to make clear that this funding should be accepted by local government to maintain teacher numbers. And let me be clear about what that will mean for those members who decide to vote against the government amendment tonight. They will be making clear that they support giving local authorities the green light to cut teacher numbers. Presiding Officer, I want to reiterate, I'm happy to do so.
Miles Briggs.
The Cabinet Secretary. Dr Sue Ellis, the former Professor of Education at Strathclyde University, stated, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary seems causal a briefing on this, that councils are stuck between a rock and a hard place on this. Would she agree that that's the position the Scottish Government's put councils in on teacher numbers?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I would not agree. There are a number of local authorities today who have managed to maintain teacher numbers. I would like to give them the funding right now. I would like to have given it to them in February. But a number of local authorities that Miles Briggs knows about and that we have debated in the Chamber in recent times have not done that. So the proposition I think being advanced by the Conservatives today, and please correct me if I'm wrong, Mr Briggs, is that I should allow funding to flow out the door, knowing that some local authorities have cut. That's not a position I think that I can justify. And I want to reiterate again today this government's long-standing policy, I have no time in hand, unfortunately, and financial commitment to protect teacher numbers. This policy is one that I will fervently defend as Education Secretary. I am absolutely clear that it will be much more difficult for our schools to respond to those challenges with fewer teachers in our schools, whether it be the PISA results, behaviour, attendance or increasing additional support needs. The professionals who make a difference in our schools are our teachers. Now, as Labour's opposition debate back in May established, we had unanimous support across the Parliament for protecting teacher numbers. In May, colleagues here specifically asked the government to prevent teacher job losses, and I expect members across the chamber will therefore support the government's amendment, which calls on COSLA to do just that. What I'm looking to do is to make sure that funding issued is done so in such a way that it is spent only on maintaining teacher numbers and not on other things, in line with the budget voted for by this Parliament in 24-25. Now, members will recall the historic position on this funding, which allowed it to flow to local authorities and then put government in a really challenging position come Teacher Census Day, where some councils maintained or increased and others took the money and cut jobs anyway. This year, we know that some councils have budgeted with the expectation of the funding flowing and they have cut teacher numbers additionally. That is not a position I can support. Because, Presiding Officer, it is that ring fencing which is protecting investment in Scotland's education system. Over 2,000 extra teachers in Scotland's schools since 2018, 725 extra learning support assistants in the last year alone, the lowest pupil-teacher ratio in the United Kingdom, £1 billion of investment through the Scottish Attainment Challenge, which is supporting an extra 3,000 staff, including 1,000 extra teachers. Now, I do recognise the challenges faced by those seeking permanent employment opportunities, which the Tory motion also references. It is an issue I am deeply frustrated by personally because it relates directly to the employment practices used by local authorities, which differ across the country and are not at the current time in the gift of the government. But it is worthwhile reminding Parliament that the numbers of teachers employed in permanent positions remains roughly stable at 80% since 2014. But as I was discussing with a teacher in Fife only this morning, that precarity of employment, particularly in primary, can have a deeply detrimental impact on the well-being of teachers, and it also directly harms retention. It is for that reason today that the government will look to accept the Labour amendment. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of time. There is a lot to be positive about in Scottish education. This government is clear. We will not withhold funding from any council that can show in the annual census that they are spending it on teachers. Many councils in Scotland today have done exactly that, and to them I say thank you. But I do, again, ask members across the chamber to unite behind the government amendment tonight and make clear that the £145.5 million, which is being made available, should be accepted by local government to maintain teacher numbers. Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Pam Duncan-Glancy to speak to and move Amendment 150.60.1 up to 4 minutes. Ms Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. I'm pleased to open this debate today for Scottish Labour and to welcome Miles Briggs in his new role. Presiding Officer, teachers are the beating heart of our education system. They're crucial to supporting our young people and their attainment. They help young people rise above their circumstances. They help them buck the trend. I know this is true because I'm here in this place because of that. The Cabinet Secretary, I think, recognises this too. She said that teachers are crucial to raising attainment and closing the attainment gap, which is why the fact that they've failed to recruit the 3,500 more teachers they said they would, and in fact numbers have dropped by 160 across Scotland last year, leaving teachers overworked and undersupported, is such a disappointment. Whilst teacher numbers are dropping, everyone knows we need more teachers in some localities and subjects and to meet commitments on non-contact time and class sizes, not fewer. And to add to the mess, we're in the bizarre situation where we have vacancies in teaching, yet thousands of newly qualified teachers are unable to get permanent jobs. Of over 2,800 teachers who completed their probation a year ago, only 29 are in full-time permanent positions. This is having a real impact on people's lives. One teacher told Teacher for Permanence that, "I'm now into my fifth year of teaching and I'm still working between fixed-term contracts and supply work. I strongly believe that the lack of permanent jobs is having a negative impact on teachers' mental health and is severely disruptive to the children." Presiding Officer, recruitment, though, is not the only issue. We also have a crisis in retention. A recent survey by the General Teaching Council found that amongst those who left in the early stages of their career, 40% cited difficulties securing a post, 19% cited lack of support, and 18% cited stress. This situation is unsustainable, and our motion seeks to address this in a way that the government's own motion falls short, because we recognise the importance of supporting teachers and supporting staff around them too. The number of children with additional support needs is increasing, and they need a whole host of staff to support them, not only teachers. It takes a village, as the saying goes. That's why it's worrying that ASN staff has dropped and the support services around schools have been somewhat hollowed out. Do I have any time in hand, Presiding Officer?
Not very much.
Okay, briefly.
Cabinet Secretary.
The member at least acknowledged that in the last year alone we've seen an increase in additional support need to learning support assistance by 725, specifically because of ring-fenced investment from this government to protect funding to that sector. Will she acknowledge
Pam
that?
Pam Duncan Glancy.
As I think the Cabinet Secretary knows, the situation for facing pupils with additional support needs in Scotland is, as the committee said, intolerable, and the situation is not improving on this government's watch. The result is that one in four children are being rejected by CAMHS, one in six children identified as in need of treatment waited more than 4 months to get help, and the problems are deeper and wider than this government seems to recognise. That the answer they think to this crisis is to hold councils to ransom by withholding £145 million from them beggars belief. The gross underfunding of local authorities means that education in general is in crisis. Some schools are having to use PEF money to recruit staff. In Glasgow, they're cutting 450 posts, leaving some schools with only one member of staff in front of class, and others are reducing teacher hours. The situation is out of control, and I'm afraid I don't think the government have grasped quite the depth or the scale of the problem. And it doesn't have to be this way. A good committed government showing leadership can support education. The UK Labour government has just demonstrated that today in the budget, with putting the many before the few by adding VAT to private schools, tripled funding for free breakfast clubs, increased school budgets by £2.3 billion, invested in school-based nurseries, increased support for ASN by £1 billion and announced an additional £300 million for further education. Presiding Officer, these are the choices of a government that supports education, and people in Scotland need the SNP government to do the same. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Duncan Glancy. I now call on Ross Greer, up to 4 minutes. Mr Greer.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was proud of the £145 million that was included in the budget from the point at which the Greens joined the government in 2021. It was the most significant request that we made in that first budget. And I'm not suggesting that it was entirely down to us. We put that forward, but clearly SNP colleagues were supportive of it as well. That should have been enough for every teacher in Scotland on a temporary contract to be moved onto a permanent one, and for the recruitment of hundreds of new permanent teaching posts. But that is obviously not what happened. And there's no single reason for that. Inflation had a really significant impact, seriously eroding the Scottish Government and local authorities' spending power. The resultant pay deal with the teaching workforce made maintaining numbers for the same amount of funding far more challenging. And there's the reality of this happening at the same time as the introduction of the Verity House Agreement, a reset of relationship with local government. No, I'm afraid not. I don't have time at this point. I do think, though, that we are at a point where we need to rethink this approach. £145 million of public money was spent with the intention of it resulting in more teachers, but we ended up with fewer teachers at the end of that first financial year. And I do not think that's all the fault of the Scottish Government. I think that councils have seriously undermined trust. They are not the only ones that undermined the Verity House Agreement. The Scottish Government clearly undermined it with the council tax freeze, and we do need to see this all in that wider context. But there's a threefold issue here. The Scottish Government quite legitimately wants to protect teacher numbers. Councils quite legitimately want to avoid having to make devastating cuts in other areas. Pam Duncan Glancy mentioned support staff as an obvious example of that. But the money doesn't exist to resolve both of those challenges simultaneously. There is a need in the longer term to resolve that funding question. The Green Amendment spoke to that, and I'll come back to it later on. But there's a much more urgent need to find some kind of compromise now. I think the first issue is a point of dialogue. COSLA want to declare this as a formal dispute. The Scottish Government reject that. Frankly, I think that's a semantic point and I don't particularly care, but I do think there's a need for some kind of space for more dialogue. COSLA have rejected the First Minister's most recent response to them.
They are insistent that the issues of teacher numbers, the National Care Service and the council tax freeze are discussed together outside of the annual budget process. And I do think, as much as I have sympathy with the Scottish Government's position, that showing some goodwill and at the very least agreeing for that discussion to take place outside the budget process might create the space for us to make some progress on this. There's another issue that's been raised with me over the last couple of weeks by councillors in a variety of local authorities who weren't sure whether this was an all-or-nothing position. If some councils were to fail to spend the money as the government prescribed, would the money be taken back from all councils? Now, that was not my understanding from what the Cabinet Secretary said, and she's nodding to agree. This is on a local authority by local authority basis. But there is clearly an issue of communication here that is also hampering any chance of a compromise being reached. I want to return briefly to the impact of the pay deal, because I think we need to acknowledge that the same amount of cash simply does not pay for the same number of teachers that it did a couple of years ago. And I think the government should be open to discussions around maintaining spend as opposed to maintaining overall teacher numbers as some kind of compromise. I do think compromise is possible here. I think the Scottish Government should be open to one. I don't expect we'll hear it in this afternoon's debate, if for no other reason than the constraints of time. Local authorities will need to show far more willingness to compromise than they've showed as well. But at this point in time, something needs to give, and it's teachers and young people who are losing out unless we can come to some kind of agreement. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Greer. I now call on Willie Rennie again. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Rennie.
I don't know what kind of crazy logic it is that leads to the conclusion that cutting £145.5 million from local authority budgets will protect teacher numbers. Local authorities will have to respond to that if their funds are cut even further. How do they balance the books? The Scottish Government know, just in a second, the Scottish Government know that they are under a tight financial constraints, so there will have to be a reaction and will take an intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
To follow Mr Rennie's logic, because as we've heard today, we've had 2 years of consecutive reductions in teacher numbers where the government has not acted to claw back funding. We are now going into year three. Last year, in fact earlier this year, the member will recall that I said, let's not fund in this way in the future, let's fund through a grant process which up front asked local authorities to agree to maintain teacher numbers. They refused to do that. So to Mr Greer's point about consensus and trying to work with local authorities, that's exactly what I've been doing since February to get this funding out the door. They will not agree to it. Some of them want the funding and they want to cut. Is that a position Mr Rennie supports?
Willie Rennie, I can give you some of the time.
It's working on a misunderstanding that the local authorities, the Education Secretary seems to think that local authorities, including SNP-run Glasgow City Council, is hell-bent on destroying Scottish education. Now, why on earth she thinks that? If the Scottish Government were to be treated this way by the Westminster Government, as she's treating local government, there would be an outcry. Where is the Verity House Agreement? Where is the historic Concordat, where local authorities were supposed to be working in partnership with central government? Now we're issuing threats on a regular basis because somehow local authorities can't be trusted with our education system. She has really destroyed the relationship with local authorities and with schools. And the people that are paying the price are teachers, because there is a complete incoherence within the Scottish Government's position. They have got promises and they've got difficulties here of recruiting 3,500 extra teachers in order in part to cut the teacher contact time by 90 minutes and has been in the commentary making sure that there is more permanent places and also a cut in temporary contracts. But none of that has been met. So I understand the Cabinet Secretary's problem. But to think that local authorities are the problem in this relationship, rather than the funding that she's providing to the local authorities, is a complete misunderstanding of the issue. And Ross Greer is bang on about this, because he has highlighted the fact that this money doesn't have the same values it used to have. Inflation, pay deals have gone through the roof, and that's affected it. In the way that John Swinney said in May was an issue, he said, we live in the real world. The Education Secretary is not living in the real world. She's expecting local authorities not to live in the real world, but her world, where she is able to issue threats on a regular basis about funding. So is it logical, her position? But there is also a problem here. What's happening to the pipeline of teachers? We know that there's not been the extra 3,500 extra teachers recruited, but yet the pipeline continues from ITEs. Teachers are coming into the, particularly the primary education world, thinking there's going to be a job for them, but the Scottish Government have not provided the funding that's necessary in order for them to be employed. She's not living in the real world, but these teachers are expected to live in the real world when they're without a job or an opportunity or years on end without a permanent contract. And I think the Education Secretary knows that I'm right about this. She knows that she has got an incoherent position where she is expecting local authorities to live in an incredibly tight financial budget but deliver the promises that she's made in her manifesto back in 2021. So she is incoherent. She needs to sort this out. Otherwise, schools, teachers, but also local authorities will continue to suffer.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate. I call for Stephen Kerr to be followed by George Adam. Up to 4 minutes, Mr Kerr.
The whole problem is, about this £145 million, is that there is no specific agreement about how that money will be spent, frankly. I've asked that question 100 times. I've asked to see the documentation that goes with the agreement of £145 million. It's never been produced because it doesn't exist. But I wish to use my time today to address the impending crisis in the Falkirk Council area, where the Council is proposing to cut the school week due to SNP funding cuts. Less time in the classroom for children to learn. It's axiomatic that the more time children spend in the classroom learning, the better. What Falkirk Council's proposals will do is remove the equivalent of a full year's teaching from children and young people. And I, along with many parents and pupils across Falkirk, completely opposed to these proposals. They've been contacting me and pressing the issue. It is urgent for them. It's causing great anxiety. Falkirk Council needs to drop this ridiculous plan. Now, if you sit here long enough and you listen to government ministers go through their register of excuses, you find a theme. It goes like this. This or that has nothing to do with us. These matters are in the hands of local authorities. There'd be outrage if we did anything. That's a typical response from the front bench, the government front bench. But on this issue, it is especially disingenuous, because the reason that councils like Falkirk are thinking of taking the drastic step of cutting the school week is because they have not been properly funded by the SNP government for over a decade. And we are now in the 18th year of an SNP government. And the SNP can no longer pass the buck for the mess that they have created. They must take responsibility. And given what we have put the children and young people of Scotland through over the past few years, the last thing we should be doing is reducing the school week. We shouldn't be cutting back on their education. We should be investing in their education. We shouldn't be cutting teachers' numbers or sticking newly qualified teachers on disposable temporary contracts. We should be reducing classroom sizes and widening subject choice. We should be empowering school leaders. But given the Cabinet Secretary's poor track record, I fear nothing will change, because Willie Rennie is right. The Cabinet Secretary is living in a parallel universe, not the real world. We passed motions barely a few weeks ago calling on the government to reverse its position on a couple of issues, including one relating to education. The SNP ministers have just ignored the passage of these motions. That's why when I saw the amendment in the Cabinet Secretary's name, I burst out laughing. She refers to a vote of this Parliament. The last thing that these ministers could care less about are votes of this Parliament. Such is the contempt that the SNP have for this Parliament, and such is the general apathy towards the proceedings of this Parliament. They calculate they can get away with it. But here we are again, debating Scottish education, thanks again to a motion brought to this place by the Scottish Conservatives. And there's a reason why the Scottish Conservatives are passionate about education, and why we feel so strongly that the burden of government spending cuts should never fall on classrooms. And that is because we believe in creating greater equality of opportunity right across our country. And the education and skills training are the golden ticket accessing a lifetime of opportunity. And if it really needs to be explained to members of the SNP government how awful the consequences of cutting the school week are on children and young people and their prospects, on their families, then frankly, these ministers don't deserve to sit where they sit a day longer, because they are failing Scotland. They are failing our children and young people and their futures, and failing the future of Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary should desist from the sort of grandstanding and posturing we have heard from her again this afternoon, and is writ large in her amendment.
You need to conclude.
And you can hold up a mirror if you like.
Mr. Kerr,
I'm the opposition, you're the government. I mean, if you can't do the job, you should remove yourself, and you should act to ensure that school hours in Scotland are protected.
I now call George Adam, to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Following Willie Rennie and Stephen Kerr, for once I might try and take the heat out of the debate, Presiding Officer. There's a first for everything. And maybe can I bring us back into talking about education, how we can move forward with that, because I've been a member of the Education Committee and its many guises on and off for most of my time here in the Parliament. And today, I wondered why that was always the case. And today, we had Professor Hayward talking to about her report about future education in Scotland. And that's when I kind of got the idea of why I do enjoy working in the Education Committee, because it's how we can make that difference, how we can deal with the challenges, how we can put forward that argument. And for us to do that, we all have to do that collectively. And we need to take the heat out of the debate. We need to also actually take the politics out and find a way forward for us all to have that discussion. Now, the basics in this debate is the fact that £145 million the government offered for the retention of teachers, or to ensure that there was recruitment of teachers. And that wasn't happening, as the Cabinet Secretary has already said, over a 2-3 year period. So therefore, they were saying, let's find another way of working. And COSLA and the government, in the COSLA briefing we received today, COSLA said that they would be quite happy to work with the government to find a way to find that solution. But one of the things I found quite interesting today with Professor Hayward, when we're all talking about how we reform education, move forward, there are so many players and stakeholders within education that it's difficult to take everyone with you and how you go forward. And one of the evidence we got today was from Peter Bain. He said there's two types of parents in the world, those that had a very good experience of education and those that had a bad experience of education. Well, Presiding Officer, they summed up myself and my wife, and I'll leave it to yourselves to work out which one had the good experience of education. But I love talking about these things, because it's so important that we actually do that and actually find a solution and a way forward for us with young people in Scotland. And I really take on what Miles Briggs said earlier on, Presiding Officer, about how he wants to work with others to reform education and find solutions, because I think that's what we need to do. That's what the public want us to do. You know, Mr. Rennie is very entertaining when he does his turn, and maybe there might be an opening in Blackpool Central Pier in the summer at one point for him. But basically, I think you know, we have to kind of take the heat out of the debate. We need to talk about what people are wanting to say, what parents are wanting to hear. That's one of the things I always ask the questions when we've been going through this process on electoral reforms. Parents are very important in this, and they need to be brought with these ideas that we're going forward. And for them and for the SNP, it's always about ensuring that we have these teacher numbers. And the SNP and the Scottish Government have always pushed for that. And that's the whole point of where we are in the position at this precise moment, is the fact that we're looking at ways to work with local government to ensure that we get these teacher numbers. And I find myself more often than not on the committee actually agreeing with Mr. Greer, because we seem to have a meeting of minds in these things. But I do agree with him in many of the issues that he brings up with regards to what he said in his speech earlier on. It is about everybody sitting down and talking about how we can move this forward. And that's what it's all about. It's about delivery. I can't help being the way I am. I see a problem, I want to fix it. You know, I see if there's something broken, I want to ensure that it's fixed as well. I just can't stop being that person. And I think sometimes we need to kind of maybe take a look at ourselves and look at what we're saying in these debates. It's all great having these kind of debates where we can really have showpiece debates, where we can maybe get a press headline and move things forward. But the important thing for me is delivery of the children of Scotland. And I think it's time for us to take the heat out of this debate, talk about it sensibly, and move forward.
Thank you, Mr. Adam. And I call Faisal Chowdhury, to be followed by Douglas Ross. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This disagreement between COSLA and the Scottish Government has been going since February. It is disappointing that the government has not resolved this issue and that schools will continue to miss out on funding. The Scottish Government is now facing twin crises on their own making: a failure to retain and expand teacher numbers despite promising to do so, and years of local government underfunding. In May, this Parliament voted to recognise the precarity we see in the teaching professions today. Teachers have been running on goodwill for too long. EIS research from June found far too many working beyond their contracted hours, increasing stress and decreasing job satisfaction. Many local authorities are struggling to fill posts at all. Data from the Teachers Induction Scheme shows only 66% of council requests for provisioners were filled, and less than half of maths and computing probation teachers being delivered to local authorities. These figures are made worse when we consider that less than a third of post-induction scheme teachers move into full-time employment. The Scottish Teachers from Permanence campaign also showed we have thousands of teachers who want to work but are being denied or are facing long wait on supply list before gaining temporary employment. Clearly, the current strategy is not delivering. We need clear data regularly published showing where we need more teachers and how many are on supply list, and a workforce plan to address the gaps of staffing in all areas of our schools. The consistent underfunding of local authorities has also contributed to this issue. Even if funding is released for retaining teachers, as the Scottish Government requested, other areas of education may face cuts. Additional support for learning, bus travel to and from school, and the length of the school weeks have all been in danger. Funding for this comes from core local government budget. These budgets have been disproportionately cut over the last 10 years. COSLA have noted a cut of $63 million to the core revenue budget in 2023-24. Local government financing will remain an issue regardless of the outcome of this dispute. The Scottish Government must work to urgently resolve this conflict with local authorities and publish a workforce plan to solve these longer-term issues in the teaching profession, as called for by this Parliament in May. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Douglas Ross to be followed by Evelyn Tweed. Up to 4 minutes, Mr. Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This morning I was very privileged to become the convener of the Education Committee, taking over from my colleague Sue Webber, who did a great job for 2.5 years. And I have to say, my new role has had a profound and almost immediate impact, because I've found myself sitting here agreeing almost entirely with two of my new colleagues, Willie Rennie and Ross Greer, and I hope that bodes well for the deliberations we have as a committee going forward. Maybe it doesn't bode well for either of them that I've said that. However, I don't agree with every committee member, and George Adam mentioned earlier that we met this morning, and he wanted to take the heat out of this debate. I think there has to be heat in this debate. If we can't get passionate and inspired about the education of our children and young people across Scotland, then we shouldn't be here. Mm-hmm. And the fact that we are here, as Stephen Kerr said, is again because the Scottish Conservatives have chosen to use our debating time in this chamber to focus on education. And I took some comfort, I think, in the Cabinet Secretary saying she will bring back a debate in government time on this, but we do need to be debating this far more in this chamber. We saw just this week on our news channels, Scottish Teachers for Permanence is rising up both the political agenda but also the news agenda, because this is an issue that is affecting all of our constituencies and all 32 local authorities. And in my time today, I just want to focus on my own local authority of Moray. And I spoke with the council leader, Kathleen Robertson, and the education team there and council officers to get some background on the situation we are faced with as parents in Moray and as a community. We have 54 schools educating 12,000 pupils. The budget for education in Moray is 40% of the total budget for Moray Council, and of that 40%, 80% goes on staffing. That means when this Scottish Government withholds money from Moray Council and other local authorities, that has an immediate and significant impact on our teachers, our pupils, our schools and the education system locally and nationally. We've had significant problems recruiting teachers in many subjects, technical, home economics, etc. That's now extended to mathematics and English as well. We are struggling to recruit teachers across the board, and indeed in some of our schools, pupils are going an entire session without a full complement of teachers in their particular subjects. And that's not only having an impact on the pupils themselves, it obviously has a significant impact on the teachers who remain, who are having to pick up an awful lot of the slack. And we've seen an increase, according to Moray Council, in referrals to occupational health, with stress, anxiety and depression now the key reasons for teacher absence in Moray. We need to do something about this, not just for the generation who are being taught, but for our teachers who are struggling and many are at breaking point. And that's why this debate is important today. That's why we need more than what we've heard so far from the Cabinet Secretary to say, pitching local government against central government. We need them both to work together to come up with a solution that delivers for everyone. In my last few seconds, I want to focus on another issue that I've raised many times, and this is the issue of people coming from England with qualifications who can't immediately get into education in Scotland. We have an army barracks and an RAF base where many of the spouses are trained in England with qualifications there who can't get into teaching because they can't get the GTCS accreditation for 190 days. And we have this strange situation where Moray pupils quite often go from the high schools on Wednesday to UHI Moray College to be taught by a lecturer there who is not accredited with GTCS. But if that lecturer were to come into a classroom in a Moray school, they would have to be accompanied with someone with that accreditation. So I hope that is an issue we can perhaps discuss and develop more with the Cabinet Secretary going forward, because that would certainly be one of the areas where we could make improvements in Moray. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Ross. I now call Evelyn Tweed, the final speaker in the open debate, up to 4 minutes. Ms Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I would like to welcome Douglas Ross and Miles Briggs to their new position today. Contributions from colleagues show that the situation is indeed challenging. If we zoom out, we see that the number of teachers in Scotland have risen by 8% since 2014. Despite a profoundly challenging financial situation, the Scottish Government is also providing a record £14 billion settlement for local government in 2024-25, a real terms increase of 2.5% compared to last year. Despite this, it's clear that changes are needed that go far beyond funding. The situation is difficult, and a more complicated picture emerges when we break down teacher training and recruitment figures, as other members have mentioned today. Primary teacher education courses usually hit or exceed their targets. However, this has led to an oversupply, and many primary teachers are struggling to obtain a permanent contract. The picture is different for secondary teachers. Recruitment for the postgraduate diploma in education is much lower. Some subjects face more acute challenges than others. This year, Scotland's 32 authorities requested 117 technological education probationers, but in reality received just 39. For maths, 164 probationer teachers were requested, but 71 were allocated. Secondary teacher shortages lead to subjects being cut, which reduces pupils' subject choice. Lower teacher numbers then lead to more stressful working conditions for teachers and may result in more people leaving the profession, which is not what we want. This also puts strain on others to stay. Research carried out in England suggests that a lack of good promotion prospects and job security are key factors in leading those considering careers in teaching to ultimately decide against it. We should develop an understanding of the factors at play in Scotland so that we can address the undersupply of secondary school teachers. Some measures have been put in place, for example, the preference waiver scheme through this, probationers agree to be placed at a school anywhere in Scotland and receive a payment as an incentive. I welcome the government's commitment to taking greater care to allocate these probationers to areas of the greatest need. However, numbers of preference waiver probationers are dropping, and I call on the government to carry out research to better understand why this is the case. Given the pressure on housing in many areas of Scotland and the high cost of living, it is perhaps not surprising that fewer people feel comfortable taking that leap of faith. Concrete data on this would allow for targeted measures to tackle the root cause of this drop. The importance of the role that teachers play in our society cannot be overstated. Despite best intentions, there is room for improvement, and I call on the government to explore a more flexible and collaborative approach to training, recruitment and retention. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Tweed. We now move to the closing speeches, and I call first Ross Grey, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday it was Liz Smith and Willie Rennie agreeing with me. Today it's Douglas Ross and Willie Rennie agreeing with me. All I can say is that I'm glad my party conference was last weekend rather than this coming weekend, or my notoriously restless membership might be proposing a motion of censure. But I do think that there is something constructive and positive about our ability, particularly yesterday's debate on fiscal sustainability, and in some of the points made today, begin to identify areas of consensus. I think the core issue that we're dealing with today, though, is an unresolved tension that's been going on for the 25 years of this Parliament's existence, which is that education is considered a national issue and the Scottish Government is judged on issues like teacher numbers, but it's our local authorities who actually deliver education and who are the employers of those working in our schools. And no party, including my own, I think, has an obvious way to resolve that. I certainly wouldn't support the complete centralisation of education. I don't think any of us would want to see a situation where this Parliament had nothing to do with it whatsoever. But we are in that messy point in the middle where these kind of conflicts emerge. And there's a democratic point as well here. I do want £145 million to be used to recruit and retain teachers in our schools. I also respect that local authority elected representatives have just as much democratic legitimacy as I do, and they are the employers of those working in our schools. And there's obviously a tension between those two positions. On this specific conflict, as I said earlier on, I do think that compromise is possible here. And as much as I recognise that the Cabinet Secretary can't have these discussions with COSLA through the medium of me, I would like to, if she could, in closing, if she could respond to the suggestion that I've made around maintaining spend rather than maintaining headcount being a potential area for discussion at the very least. The Green amendment that wasn't selected for this afternoon took this debate into the grounds of local government finance, because that is core to why we are here. This is one of the many consequences of this Parliament for 25 years having failed to reform local government finances in Scotland. It's not normal to have a tier of government that raises, I believe, only about 20% of its own funding. We talk a lot about Scotland being, or aspiring to be, a normal European country. What's normal for European local government is for local government to be able to raise at least half, at least a majority, of its own funds, and that's not the case here in Scotland. There's a whole range of steps that we could take, that we could have taken, and can still now. Most obviously, at the very least, we should be revaluing council tax. We would not be taxing people's income on the basis of what it was 34 years ago, but we seem to believe it's appropriate to do that with council tax. We should let councils fully set rates and bands, not just be able to set band D and have everything else locked in around it. Ideally, we should replace the council tax. It wasn't the right system in the first place. It's certainly not fit for purpose now. We should give local authorities far more power to raise revenue or not to. We should give them the option of using these powers if they so wish. The Greens have put forward proposals for a carbon emission land tax, a demolition levy, a stadium levy. We ultimately believe councils should have a power of general competence to do this for themselves. But we accept that that's not going to happen immediately. and be able to resolve this issue. So I would urge the Scottish Government to show some goodwill to COSLA here, frustrating as they often are. I'm not usually their greatest defender, but there is a need for dialogue on this, the National Care Service and the council tax freeze, out with the annual budget process. That's all COSLA have asked for at this point in time. I would encourage the Cabinet Secretary to show them some good faith and for either herself, the First Minister or the Cabinet Secretary for Finance to agree to engage in those discussions so that we can move this forward. I do not think we should be in a situation where we are simply waiting to see who blinks first on a question as important as how our schools are funded and how many teachers are in our classrooms.
Thank you, Mr Greer. And I call Martin Whitfield again, around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to close on behalf of Scottish Labour this debate, again brought by an opposition party with regard to education. Can I first welcome Myles Briggs to his new responsibilities and wish him all well with it? And can I also extend to Douglas Ross my congratulations on his leverage to the convener of Education Committee. This has been an interesting debate, which has, I think, captured, if not some of the minutiae of what's so important about this, certainly the field on which it's being played, from the very thoughtful contribution from Evelyn Tweed regarding the realities of what's happening. And I found it particularly poignant to think of our COSLA colleagues requesting 117 technical teachers, one of the hardest areas to recruit into, and yet receiving only 39. And then again, if I can return to Douglas Ross's contribution, particularly about Murray, in the very articulate way that he expressed the challenge of what it's like, to use an old-fashioned phrase, on the chalk face. Because the reality is that our local authorities, our schools, both high schools and primary schools, are facing an enormous challenge, which we have, I would say, rehearsed, but we have certainly articulated in this chamber on a number of occasions and over a number of debates, from the violence that's happening in schools, from the challenge of teachers having to seek help for their own mental health because of the mental health they find their children that they feel responsible to deal with, and perhaps not just responsible, but at times ill-equipped to deal with, because some of the complexities that young people are coming into schools with have never been faced by an education system throughout the history of it. The challenges that families are facing is enormous, and indeed there have been many contributions that have pointed to the challenge that if you cut core local authority funding, you indeed cut the services that surround and expect and allow a school to function for what it's there to do, which is to educate our young people. We've had very passionate will do?
Claire Adamson.
I don't want to dismiss in any way the concerns around this issue at all, but would the member recognise that there are reserves within local authorities in Scotland? Indeed, the Accounts Commission believes that a range of between 2% and 4% of unearmarked reserves in the general fund is a target, whereas Labour-run North Lanarkshire Council in my area actually has a 16%, £39 million of unearmarked reserves in its general fund, and that extends to £480 million across the whole of Scotland. Is this
briefly
not an area where local authorities could be accessing further
Martin
funds?
Martin Whitfield,
I'm grateful for the contribution, and I apologise for cutting across, but time is incredibly tight in this debate that was brought by the Conservatives to discuss education. Yes, there are reserves. I heard an interesting fact this morning that in a health situation, an entire IJB's reserves were taken. So I think this is part of the argument, and I don't want to discount it. However, it also brings to point the other thing that I wish to raise, which, oh, how begrudgingly it means that I have to agree with Ross Greer again, but I do so with a certain level of enthusiasm on this occasion, because I think he articulated one side of the argument that people outside of this place sometimes find challenging to understand or even to be aware of. And that is the tension that exists between COSLA and this Scottish Government. And I say this in the kindest terms possible, but some of the contributions from the front bench when Mr Greer was talking about this, I think, reflects the challenge that we have. I don't know the number of debates I've been in where we have been asked to work together, where we've been asked, if you can't just all agree, we could get this thing sorted. And actually today, I think that Ross Greer has rightly pointed out one of the great challenges. There is a breakdown in communication. I think it is very challenging sometimes for individuals to accept that that is the case. But I think if you can accept the case that there is a challenge in the breakdown of communication, there is a possibility then that when people sit in a room, an agreement can be made. I'm disappointed but fully understand the shortness of this debate this afternoon for very good reasons, so I'll leave it at that point and thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whitfield. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary. Around 5 minutes, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I thank Miles Briggs for bringing what is a hugely important topic to the Chamber this afternoon. I think it's been an interesting debate at times. I want to respond to some of the points raised in the debate this afternoon. But I again start by reminding the Chamber that every single MSP in this Chamber stood on a manifesto commitment in 2021 to increase teacher numbers. We all made promises to the people who elected us. Now, I was in Willie Rennie's constituency this morning in the real world, talking to one of his real-life constituents. She has been impacted by employment practices of a local authority who last year took funding from central government and cut teacher numbers anyway. The incoherence in his logic is simply breathtaking, particularly when Mr Rennie stood on a commitment in 2021 to, and I quote the Liberal Democrat manifesto, boost the teacher workforce. Now, to Stephen Kerr and parallel universes, I don't think Mr Kerr has done his homework. He is huffing, he is puffing, he wants action. And I don't agree with any proposals for his understanding to reduce the school working week and to reduce school hours, which is why, had he attempted to show his working, he would know that I've been very clear that should any local authority in Scotland propose to reduce school working hours, then the Scottish Government would introduce regulation to protect learning hours and learning outcomes as a result. That's a power that rests with Scottish ministers. So I want to give him that reassurance, Presiding Officer, this afternoon. George Adam spoke for the need for less heat, more light. And I do agree with Ross Grier that we do need to move forward. The issue here is the one I think he alludes to with regard to the National Care Service, the council tax freeze. The wider issues here, for example, as Mr Kerr has alluded to in relation to learning hours. And I suppose that's also part of Mr Rennie's argument too, to some extent, which seemed to be that funding should flow to local authorities irrespective. And I again, Presiding Officer, would remind members of the COSLA briefing from December of 2022, which showed that local authorities were planning cuts of up to 8,000 teacher numbers. Now, had Scottish Government not taken direct action at that time, we'd be in a far more challenging position at the current time. It is because of that ring-fenced allocation and that protection of spending that we've been able to maintain and increase teacher numbers compared to 2018, for example, by over 2,000. Faisal Troudy talked to some of the longer-term issues in relation to the teaching profession, and I recognise that time is tight today, Presiding Officer, but I do think it worthwhile putting on the record some thoughts in relation to the Conservative motion, which also talked to issues associated with workload. I met with the EIS on this issue only yesterday to talk to a really substantive independent report they published, looking at real challenges in terms of teacher workload post-pandemic. So we need to have a renewed drive on reducing unnecessary teacher workload. We know that that in some schools is leading to burnout, for example. And our trade union colleagues have undertaken some really substantive work, as I alluded to, on this issue. And I committed to work with the EIS and our professional trade union associations on that, who, of course, represent our teaching workforce. I also think a key part of the challenge here in relation to workload is on reducing class contact. And I've committed again to working with the trade unions with urgency on this issue. And as I am sure our council colleagues know, it won't be possible to reduce class contact by having fewer teachers in our schools. Now, Douglas Ross, I thought, made a number of really interesting points, not least in relation to his own constituency and GTCS accreditation. He knows I have a soft spot for Moray, having completed my probation year at Elgin High School some years ago now, and I'm happy to commit to working with him and the General Teaching Council on what more we might be able to do in that space. Happy to do so.
Liz Smith.
I'm really pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary agree with that.
Can we have
a good speech? I have to say, Mary Scanlon, one of our former colleagues, made this very same point 9 years ago, and nothing has happened. Will the Cabinet Secretary undertake to ensure that it does happen?
Yes, to the member's point, and I've made that commitment today. It's on the record to Mr Ross. I'm happy to work with her additionally on this issue, although I think 9 years ago I perhaps was still in a classroom myself. Now, I think also Douglas Ross really hits on the solution today, which essentially is how we can work with COSLA to reach a resolution to get the funding out the door. And of course, the First Minister and I have committed to do exactly that, most recently in correspondence only last week. Presiding Officer, I am conscious of time, but I am asking members today to unite behind the government's very simple one-line amendment, which asks us to make clear that the £145.5 million which is being made available by the Scottish Government should be accepted by local government. It should be used to protect teacher numbers, to improve outcomes for all of Scotland's children. I hope that is something all parties can unite behind, and I move the amendment in my name. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Rose McCall to wind up around 6 minutes. Ms McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be closing this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And although the line-up may have changed, the salient points made in the contributions from my colleagues are still as important and pertinent now as they were under the excellent stewardship of my colleagues Liam Kerr and Sue Webber. Again, the Scottish Conservatives are using their time in chamber to highlight the issues, or should I say failings, surrounding education in Scotland. It's a fundamental Conservative belief that education is the key to every person going on to achieve their full potential. But I would go further. Not only is education a powerful thing, but education is power. Power in oneself, power that comes from understanding and belief, power in one's own ability to work through life's problems, power in the job market, power that knowledge will provide a secure future, power that comes from knowing you can do whatever you set your mind to. It's a gift, it's hope, it's potential. It's the bedrock and foundation to all the changes we need in our society. So why has this SNP government failed in this? The Cabinet Secretary consistently contributes to debates, highlighting the amount of money spent, but ignores the lack of tangible results. For money spent, we should be seeing rapid changes in literacy and numeracy that's simply not happening. It's not correct to say that attainment is improving. It's stagnant at best. The dial has barely moved and it's moving in the wrong direction. It's not correct to say that it's solely down to poverty. As we know, that education is the most tried and tested route out of poverty, and it's a lever that we're not pulling. The Cabinet Secretary talks today of maintaining teacher numbers, but when cash-strapped councils are left with no option but to cut teacher numbers in the first place, and then they're penalised by withholding £145 million, which all but secures an increase to cuts in other priorities that the government is trying to avoid. The SNP benches are so good at asking what cuts should be made, so I wonder, would they be willing to advise our local authorities just where the cuts should come from? Would a reduction in ASN staff be more preferable? What about early intervention specialists or social workers?
Cabinet Secretary.
Listen to the member's logic here, but it is the case that a number of local authorities have managed to maintain and some have increased teacher numbers in the last year. We know that. So what the member is outlining are political choices being taken by certain local authorities who believe that I should allow them to have the funding and to cut. Is that a position that the Conservatives support?
Rose McCall.
Thank you. No, thank you for the intervention. But no, what I'm saying is that if they're looking at cutting teacher numbers, which they are, and then you're highlighting that you're going to withhold the funds, then the only thing that can be done is to take cuts from elsewhere if they keep the teacher numbers there. So I'm going to add to a couple of contributions from today. I'm looking forward to working with Miles Briggs, and I welcome his commitment from Mr Briggs on literacy and phonics. And I note the commitment from the Cabinet Secretary to bring that to the Chamber for discussion, and I look forward in doing that. Ross Grier and Willie Rennie both mentioned the Verity House agreement. I have to highlight that COSLA's briefing for today, it highlighted that the £145.5 million will not actually fully support the teacher numbers, and the pay deal for 24-25 has local government needing to contribute £135 million and the Scottish Government contributing £43 million to meet the cost of those pay awards. So there's an element of the money's not actually going to keep the teacher numbers anyway. And it's difficult for me to accept that the Cabinet Secretary can use the autonomy for local authorities card as and when it suits, but not in this case. I thought we had an excellent contribution from Stephen Kerr. I think passion in education is imperative. I don't think it was huffing. And I disagree with George Adam. We shouldn't be taking the fire out of this debate. We should be increasing the passion, increasing the drive to make change, and increasing the prospects for children in Scotland. Our teachers go out to work hoping to impart their love of their subject to children. But in Scotland, most teachers and school staff are witnesses and being subjected to considerable instances of negative behaviour. 2/3 of staff have encountered general verbal abuse. Almost 3 in 5 have encountered physical aggression, and over 2 in 3 have experienced physical violence between pupils in the classroom in the last week, which was according to a Scottish school report back at the end of 2023, and I use that on purpose. The EIS branch report in January of 2024 backs up those findings, stating violence and aggression is an urgent issue within Scotland schools, with incidents being experienced every week in over 3/4 of schools, and daily in many. It goes on to say that most schools reported that the amount of violence and aggression, including prejudice-based violence, has grown in the last 4 years. So what have we had from the Scottish Government regarding this appalling working environment for our teachers? A plan built on a plan based on a consultation. That's done precisely nothing. We're a full year on from those reports that I mentioned, and our teachers are still subjected to increasing levels of violence. Presiding Officer, our teachers are struggling. They need support. They need working conditions that will allow them to do their job. They need secure and permanent employment. They need to be able to trust that the Education Department, through their local authority, is equipped, adequately funded, and working in partnership with them to empower the children in their charge. We should be empowering them to take control of the curriculum in their classroom. They should be able to experiment with different teaching methods that ignites interest. And we should be delegating powers down to our head teachers so they've got more control financially as well over their schools. What we don't need is a Scottish Government that hands out detention when local authorities step out of line.
Thank you, Ms McCall. That concludes the debate on funding for teachers and schools in Scotland. There'll be a brief pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow the front benches to change.